Mrs. Allsup's out.
I remember one day with my brother. We led a very protected life, and we went down to the end of Summit Drive, to the end where the gate was, and we went outside. We adventured down there, and there was a lady passing, and we said to her, "We're Charlie Chaplin's children." And she must have thought, "Oh, God, these horrible brats." And so she said, "And who's he?" And we ran upstairs to our room, and we were shaking and horrified. Maybe it wasn't true. Maybe he wasn't the most famous man in the world. Maybe it was all a lie. Maybe...
The whole world knows about you, Charlie.
What news?
Your mum is fine. Well, no, not fine, but there are lots of good days.
He talked a lot about Hannah, about his mother, but never the dark side of her, never the fact that she was insane, that she was lunatic, as they said then. He was not very healthy as a little boy, and his mother would sit at the window when he was in bed, sick, and she would just describe everything that went on outside and imitate it and say, "And now there's this man," and she would imitate the man, and there's his little boy, and there's this woman, and she would just tell stories about what was going on outside the window. And he says that that was the first thing that made him want to be an actor. It was his mother.
Today, I'll report you. You're 2 months behind.
So our grandmother, who we never knew, was a source of great laughter. Sydney is the funniest man in the world.
All right, sonny boy. Tell your poor little brother today's problem.
Same as yesterday, and the day before that, and the day before that.
And the day before that, and the day before that.
All right, you be creative for a change.
Sydney is absolutely... totally outrageous and so, so funny and so charming. He can get away with absolutely anything. And he and my father had a fantastic relationship. I think he must have known that he was the greatest, but I think he had a problem wondering if everyone else still thought so. He loved public, and his kids were a great public for him. And then if we went to a restaurant, he had an even bigger public. And so in Switzerland, we used to go to a restaurant, and he would always order truite au bleu, which is, it's a trout, and it's boiled live, so it's sort of looks at you. And we would be horrified, and he'd pick up the plate and he'd take this trout and he'd say, "Emma, Emma, darling," and he'd kiss the trout on the lips, and we'd go, "Oh, Daddy, how horrible." And then he'd start eating the trout, and he'd eat the eyes, and he'd be screaming with laughter. We'd see his films, but that was mostly because of my mother. She had copies in 16 millimeters of all the films. And he was always very reticent to see his films. He was always afraid that maybe they weren't as good as they had been. We never actually knew that other people made films when we were little, because we saw Charlie Chaplin's films, but we didn't see any other films. And so he was the greatest man in the world because he was the only man that made films.
Perhaps you've heard of me.
But you're not the great comedian.
I was. However, we won't go into that.
You must speak. It's our only hope.
To me, it's the most amazing scene, because it starts out and he's the Jewish barber dressed up as Hitler. Everyone thinks he's Hitler. And that's at the same time, it's a goodbye to the trap. It's the most poignant and actual speech I've ever heard. It's an incredibly daring shot. It's incredibly modern. And he comes out, if you see the film, you see the end, he comes out, his face, Charlie Chaplin's face comes out of that. And it's him giving his speech to the world, to anyone who will listen to him.
As for being a mass killer, does not the world encourage it? Is it not building weapons of destruction for the sole purpose of mass killing?
Again, if you look at Monsieur Verdoux, he is the underdog. I mean, Monsieur Verdoux is a man who has done everything according to the laws of society, and he's out. Suddenly they kick him out. And the kid, they're taking this little kid to an horrible orphanage. In the King in New York, they break this boy's spirit and take him away, and they make him denounce his parents.
We consider Rupert a hero and a real patriot. We're all very proud of him here.
In both cases, a little boy that's being taken away from where he should be, from love and affection, by the state to do good.
The committee cites this witness for contempt of Congress.
That's very unsportsmanlike on your part.
The power to make people laugh, it's enormous, and to ridicule someone like Hitler. Maybe Hoover was scared that Daddy might ridicule him.
Charlie.
What? What is it, sweetheart? Is it Sid?
No.
What is it?
They've thrown you out.
He repeated so often, I'm not bitter, that you know that he must have been. I mean, he must have been. It was absolutely despicable. It was so horrible to the way they treated him. And he was someone who, more than anyone, more than any artist I know, I mean, he loved people. He was such a generous man, and he loved people. That's what his films are all about. They're about people and a love for humanity and an optimism for humanity. I remember once, he was then very old, and I came with a boyfriend of mine. We arrived and he spoke with my father a little bit and about the silent films and about this film, and then he went on to talk about Buster Keaton. And my father he got smaller and smaller, and he shrunk, and he was so hurt, it was like someone had stabbed him. And he just became very, very quiet. And suddenly he peeped in a little voice, he looked at my friend in the eyes and he said, but I was an artist.